This was what's called a log structure file system. The first author was Mendel Rosenblum, who was a UVA math student in the 80s. Did this while he was a PhD student at Berkeley, is the co-founder of VMware. I don't think they patented the log structured file system, so even though lots of systems used it, they didn't make a lot of money off that, but did pretty well on VMware. His father was actually a math professor here. So the idea is we're going to write sequentially. We're never going to overwrite. We're just going to fill up our space as we go. We don't ever have to do a seek because we're just going to keep writing in order as we go as we need to. So we can pick places to write that won't be hard to seek to, and we're just going to fill things up. So this sounds like a pretty simple idea. So we'll start writing our disk blocks and we'll fill them up as we go. When we update file one, instead of changing the contents stored, we're just going to write a new version of that disk block. So is it this simple? What are the things that we should be worried about if this is our new design for a file system? Okay, good. So we have to have some way to find the correct version of file one, the correct version of that block. And I probably shouldn't call these files. So we're thinking here of files, they're really blocks, and all the blocks are actually the same size. So what else do we need if we want to have files? Yes. Yeah. We still need inodes, or something like inodes. We need some way to have a file that has a disk map that says, here's all the contents of that file. Well, we can write that here, right? We can write inodes. They could point like this. And well, when we update that block, we want to change this. Can we do that? That would require erasing, right? So we can't change the inode when we update the block. We got to write a new inode. So these are the kind of things we get into. So we'll look at some of that in a little more detail. So we've got our blocks. And after our blocks, we've got our inode. Our inode has pointers to all the blocks. Started talking about flash. This was originally designed for disks. So if we're doing this for disks, when do we want to actually do the writes? Good, yeah. So we definitely want to buffer them, right? And we want to buffer writes. Any file system, we want to buffer writes. We want to be a little careful about buffering writes because part of the point of the file system is to have persistence. So if the program crashes or the machine loses power, we don't want to lose the things that we thought we wrote before. So we can't buffer for too long. But what we really want to do is buffer long enough that we can do a bunch of writes sequentially. Our goal is to be able to do all the writes without doing a seek. So we'd like to be able to do writes at the rate that the disk is spinning. So we'd like to have enough writes ready to go that we're doing them at the rate the disk is spinning. So that requires having a buffer and keeping track of things. And we're going to have some blocks in an in-memory buffer waiting until we've got enough to avoid needing a seek to do the next write waiting in that buffer. So we'll fill things up. And now we're going to do a modification. So now we've changed the value of part of the file that inode A pointed to. So what are all the things we have to do now? So are we done? Is it enough to just write the new block one? Yeah, what else do we have to do? Yeah, we need to write a new inode. Right, that inode no longer is correct, so we're going to have to write a new inode that now instead of pointing, right, this one, no longer valid, because it pointed the old block one, which is no longer valid. So we got to write a new inode, and now that's update. And it can point to the old blocks. They haven't changed, so that's okay. What happens when we're actually looking for an inode? So we've got our file, we know what inode it's supposed to be stored at. How do we actually find it? Yes. Okay, so we have to so if we had to read the whole disk, so maybe that would work. Sounds really expensive, right? If we have to read the whole disk to find an inode. And that would presume, yeah, we could put enough meta information in the inodes to know which one they are. Maybe we need a timestamp unless we know that they're all being written in some order. We got to know which one's the most recent one. And I'm drawing this like we're just filling up the disk forever. Eventually, the disk is going to be full. So we're going to go back and use places. So we can't necessarily tell that the latest one is the latest one. So what should we do instead if we don't want to read the whole disk every time we have to look for an inode? Yes. Yeah, we should have some extra level of interaction. We should have some map that gets us to the inode we want. And remember, with the old file system, how did we actually find the inode we wanted with the old Unix-style file system? Did we need to do any searching to find that inode? What did that number mean? Yeah, so that's actually like a memory address. Right, we don't need to search anything. That tells us some specific location on the disk. That's exactly where it is. So there's no extra indirection there. There is something going on in the disk controller to map that to some particular location on the disk. But there's nothing the operating system or the file system has to do to get there. For this, there is, because we don't know where the inode. We can't think of inodes as memory addresses anymore, or disk addresses, because they change. So we need some extra mapping. So we're going to have a mapping that now is a pointer to the most recent version of inode. When we updated inode A, this pointer that used to point to here now gets updated to point to there. Except for, remember, we're in this log structured file system world. We can't just erase things. What I did was just erasing, changing it. So what do we really have to do? So where's the inode map stored? So maybe you know, we could have a cache in memory. Then we could erase. That would be good. But we need this to be persistent. If we shut our machine down, this inode map better not be lost. This is really important. So this is on the disk as well. Yeah. Okay. So it could be a fixed location on the disk. That suggests that we have to seek to that location and rewrite it every time it changes. And our whole goal is not to have to do any seeks or rewriting, right? We don't want to do any erasing. So a fixed location doesn't work. Every time we change it, if we don't do erasing, we got to rewrite it. So this IMAP is actually going to be rewritten, and it's always going to be the last thing. Every time that we do any change that modifies an inode, we need to rewrite the IMAP on the disk, and it's going to be at that last location. So we're going to be able to find the IMAP pretty easily. It's not necessarily the last thing, because we could do some updates that don't require changing the IMAP, but actually, it's very unlikely to do any updates at the end that don't require changing the IMAP, because if we update a block, we also have to update the inode if we're using that new block, unless we did those out of order. So it can always be the last thing on the disk. The good news is it's pretty small. Right? So it sounds pretty expensive that every time we do a write that updates an inode, we've got to write this IMAP. And it sounds like that's pretty big because it's a map of all the nodes on the disk. But it's not huge, especially once we start thinking about we've got gigabytes on our drive. We just need 4 bytes for every inode here. So it's not huge. We should start to be worried that our disk is going to overflow. We've done all these things that increase the amount of things we've got to write to the disk. Since we're not erasing, we're just filling. So what do we need to do to avoid running out of space? We don't want to waste all our space storing blocks that have old data. So what should we do with the old data? So this is sort of like something you should remember. I don't know if you can make sense out of that picture. It made sense at the time I was drawing it, but it looks kind of incomprehensible now. Reclaiming unused disk blocks is very similar to reclaiming unused memory. We talked about how a garbage collector works, and the main idea for the garbage collector is you find all the blocks that aren't used, and you reclaim those. And you can find blocks that are used because there has to be some reference to those blocks from either the stack or some global data, or something that you can reach from those locations. How is this different on the disk? Is it easier or harder to find all the garbage? So what's the equivalent of the stack? Right, so we did garbage collection in memory by starting from the stack and following all the pointers on the stack to mark up memory that could be reached. How do you find all the disk blocks that are still valid? Yes, exactly. Right, so it's very similar. It's quite a bit simpler in the sense that there's no pointers from disk blocks to other disk blocks. All the pointers to disk blocks are in inodes, and all the way to reach inodes is from this IMAP, every reachable inode. So it is much more constrained than regular garbage collection. If we're doing garbage collection at this point, we're going to follow this IMAP. It's going to point to these two, and we're going to follow this one. Block zero has been updated, so this is garbage. So this is the reachable block 0, the reachable block 1 is this, and the reachable block 2 is still this one. So these two are garbage. And from this one, inode B, the reachable block 5, the reachable block 4, and the reachable block 3. This is garbage, and this is garbage. So you're just following those references through the inodes to figure out what's garbage. Now, if you're doing this for a disk, or an unerasable storage, or expensive to erase, do you want to do it the same way we did mark and sweep for memory? Good. Okay, so one strategy would be, yeah, you identify the things that are garbage, and this is a good idea, right? So you could identify the things that are garbage. So if you identify the things that are garbage, and you just mark these as now available. Oops, that one wasn't garbage. So you could keep track of these things are now available. And when we get back to the next time we're writing, we can now write into those spaces. This is going to fragment our disk horribly if we do that. So it's a good idea that it would work. It saves doing any copying. It's a big problem if our disk ends up getting fragmented, right? Because now when we're doing the sequential write, which we wanted to do a fast write keeping up with the speed of the disk. Now we're actually scattered. We've got to keep waiting, looking for these good blocks. So what it does instead is actually takes the live blocks that are good and writes those into a new segment and erases the whole segment. We're going to get a whole clean segment, and we wrote just the blocks that were collected here. Well, we also had to update the inodes, because if those blocks moved, we need new references to them. So this isn't free. We still have to do those updates. But it's better than having a disk get all fragmented. So now we've got a full clean segment. This was 1991, where the implementation of the log structured file system paper came out. This was a few years after the flash memory paper. But they were not doing this thinking about flash memory. They were doing this thinking about traditional disks. Why were they not thinking about flash memory yet, if the paper was already out a few years ahead of this? Yeah, it cost a fortune. So the cost of flash memory has dropped precipitously since then. Really hard to see on this graph. I think these are flash memory up here. But even just in the last 10 years, it's gone from 25 cents a megabyte to less than a dollar a gigabyte. And it wasn't until about 2011 that laptops started having SSDs in them, and now almost all laptops do, even the cheap ones. Okay. So this has been a long time getting the cost down to the point where you can replace disk drives for most uses. Now, flash memory is different from a disk in ways that actually impact how to build a file system. But it turns out that the log structured file system is actually a great idea for building a file system for flash, even though they weren't thinking about that, because it has this property of not erasing. The main property we have with flash is erasing is expensive. We don't care about sequential anymore. The blocks can be anywhere. So we don't even care about these fragmentation issues. Referencing each block takes the same amount of time, roughly. What we care about is erasing, but we can do some updating. So one of the cool things that the flash memory file systems do is you can keep a block where it's a bitmap of blocks being used, and you don't have to erase to mark a block that was unused to be used. Because you can do this 1-to-0 rewrite cheaply. It's only expensive if you have to go in the other direction, and then you have to rewrite the whole block. So there are clever things that you do that take advantage of the one-way updating being possible. But there are also lots and lots of complexities. So one of the things that we talked about with flash memory, bits can wear out if you use the same block too many times. If you read too close to other blocks too many times, you can disrupt the values stored in those other values. So there are lots and lots of complex things. Where should we deal with those? Whose responsibility is it to deal with things like figuring out if the flash is wearing out and needing to move blocks around because of it? Yes. Yeah, the disk driver. So you mean the driver that's part of the operating system. Okay. So if you're writing that, you certainly hope not. Who knows more about these kinds of issues than the person writing the OS-specific driver for that flash? Yeah. Yeah, so you'd really like this to not be something that everyone who writes an operating system that uses this flash needs to worry about. And unlike disk drives, flash is used in all sorts of consumer devices. So it's not just one standard operating system who would have to write that one driver once. You would really like to deal with those things on the card and provide to the operating system and to whoever has to write the driver for the operating system a much cleaner interface that doesn't have to worry about blocks wearing out and things like that. And this is actually what they do. So if you zoom into your SD card, you'll see in the corner, right? So this is all the flash memory. In the corner, there's something that looks a little different. And what that is a general purpose processor, inexpensive ARM processor, or there are a few other vendors that are used for this. And that's a general purpose processor. It's running some firmware that does all these complex algorithms to deal with memory wear out and read disruption, all the things that you don't want to have to deal with if you're writing a device driver for flash. So that's good news. It's bad news because it can be hacked, and you've got a general purpose computer that can be reprogrammed on all of your memory devices. In summary, so what's actually on, if you don't have just a flash card, most hard drives today have all three layers. You've got a cache and DRAM, you've got some flash memory, and then you've got a disk. Maybe you don't have the disk, but you've probably at least got these two. So as far as what you're doing for problem set 4, you don't have to handle the physical medium. You can keep your file system in memory. I hope some team will try to think about how to make a file system that works with persistent media for your post-problem set 4 project. There are some complexities dealing with QEMU to get the right interface, but probably trying to do this for flash would be the right thing to do. And then you can name your OS flash kernel, although I really hope you won't. I don't expect you'll get that done by the problem set 4 deadline, but hopefully you're starting to think of interesting things to do for your project, which could build on problem set 4 or could be totally unrelated to it.